lecture is on sociotechnical systems. This term was coined by Rob Kling, who was a computer scientist here at UCI for many years, and who was concerned that we weren't really understanding the relationships between people and technology carefully enough. We would study people on the one hand or technology on the other and not bring them together. And Professor Kling felt it was very important that we do this in a unified way. So he said a socio-technical system includes things like people, equipment, data, resources, documents, legal arrangements, political forces, pretty much everything you can think of. It's intended to be a very broad, comprehensive, holistic concept that will allow us to study technology more fruitfully. And Professor Kling noted that we can actually use this kind of analysis to study a socio-technical system before it's deployed and think about some of the implications and the consequences. And this is actually a pretty radical idea in that usually we just develop technology, deploy it, send it out into the world, and then see what happens. But that has turned out to be the cause of many of the disruptions we're dealing with now. So another approach might be to try to anticipate some of the causes. Even though we know we can't forecast perfectly, there are some things we can study and anticipate and plan for. Kling noted that much of what we know about technology comes from what he called pundits, that is people like journalists who write for Wired, or academics who write popular books, or commentators like Jaron Lanier, who were pretty heavy on the provocation, but lighter on the analysis. And Kling felt we needed to go beyond that to a rigorous socio-technical study. This study should be evidence-based. It should not rely on personal anecdotes or boldly stated opinions. And it should not reduce the complexity of what we're looking at just to make a flashy point. And of course, that's a lot of what happens in the mainstream media or on blogs, or if you need to boil something down into a tweet. And he was saying, no, we have to do this much more expansive kind of analysis because we have people and we have technology, and this is quite a complex system. Kling did a study of online courses, and I wanted to mention that since we are together here in an online course. And he noted that online courses are said to be convenient and accessible, and that is certainly true. But if you look at what actually happens, sometimes there are problems that possibly could have been anticipated. So for example, in the course that he studied, the students felt pretty disconnected from the instructor, and there was a lot of confusion and a lot of frustration. And Kling pointed out that this was actually fairly predictable in that human communication is inherently ambiguous. In person, we deal with this through a process that linguists call repair. So if I say something and you don't understand it, you just say, what did you mean by that? And then I tell you, and then we continue our conversation. This is a lot more difficult in an online course. Kling noted that the students would send messages to the instructor, but they still felt confused. So students would report things like, usually I email her if I have any questions and her answer is very ambiguous. So I'm not going to ask a second time. And the students would just stop trying. Now, we certainly hope that this will not happen in this class, and please feel free to email us, but also to ask for a Skype call or voice-based communication, or if you're local, to come into our office and talk to us. Global disruptions always involve socio-technical systems. There's no way of getting away from this relationship between people and technology, which is ubiquitous on the planet. So whether we're looking at climate change or economic inequality or resource depletion, there's always a socio-technical system at the heart of what is going on that we need to understand. All right, let's look at how to analyze a socio-technical system. This is going to look a little bit like what we did for the analysis of human well-being. So the first question is, what are the relevant technologies? Who are the players or the stakeholders? What are the consequences? If there is a disruption, what are the different ways to deal with that disruption? And who pays? So let's take an example, the example of fracking. Fracking stands for hydraulic fracturing, and it is a technique used to obtain natural gas and some oil. And the basic idea is that you inject a lot of water underground to create pressure to fracture the rock within which there is gas or oil. And then when this fracturing has occurred, the gas or oil can escape into a well. Now, we didn't used to do this. Fracking is actually pretty new. And the reason we're doing it now is that we've pretty much used up all of the easy to get natural gas and oil. And now we need to try to find other reserves. And fracking is one way to do this. If we apply a socio-technical analysis to fracking, let's see what we get. What are the relevant technologies? Well, they're not all digital technologies, of course. Some of them are things like trucks. It takes a lot of trucks to transport the millions of gallons of water that are needed for fracking. It takes diesel engines to run the generators to power the equipment. So we're using fossil fuel to try to get at more fossil fuel. And this is a pretty energy intensive way of trying to get more energy. Who are the stakeholders? Well, of course, there are the oil companies, the commercial interests who profit from fracking. There is the government. It turns out that we are subsidizing those companies. The government has some interest in energy independence. And so from that point of view, it does make sense that we might provide some taxpayer money. So consumers and taxpayers are also, of course, stakeholders. And then there are the residents of the communities who live near the fracking wells. And that brings us to the consequences. Water depletion is a big problem. Only about 30% of the water can be recovered. So this really, really takes a lot of water to get out this natural gas and oil. The process releases toxic chemicals, benzene and methanol, that can affect local water supplies, as well as methane, a significant greenhouse gas. All right, we might ask, are there other ways to deal with these disruptions that happen to local communities and the environment and so on? And I think we can pretty easily come up with a couple of other ideas. We could invest those subsidies in greener energy sources, and we could conserve energy. One of the best ways to deal with an energy crisis is not to need the energy in the first place. And we'll be talking more in this class later about how that might happen. Okay, who pays? The taxpayers. We are already paying for fracking. And although we definitely get some benefit from it, it's also true that the oil companies sell some of the natural gas and oil to other countries. So we may not be getting complete value for our tax dollars. And of course, the residents in the nearby communities are very affected by the use of fracking. Now, it turns out there's only about 100 years of gas and oil in the ground that we could get through fracking. And that may sound like a lot to you, but we're talking about the lifetimes of your children and grandchildren. So it's not really all that distant. And it seems pretty possible that future generations will pay some of the costs of the fracking that we're doing now to get the fossil fuel. Okay, so for future reading, I highly recommend the work on general systems theory. It's been around since the 1940s. It has really withstood the test of time. It's pretty generic. It's not that hard to read. And it will give you a good sense of the underlying theory behind socio-technical systems. Thank you.